So now, without much ado, I want to shift the gears and request Mr. Umesh to give his views from the government perspective, from the overall power sector perspective. What is happening in Karnataka and how they are managing these kind of challenges on a day-to-day basis?
Good morning, sir. I am Umesh, working for a Karnataka Power Corporation, and I am in solar division and looking after the new projects, establishment of new projects, and already we have some solar projects and looking after the O&M works also. So in the solar at presently, the challenges are very less in Karnataka, because our ESCOMs and government of Karnataka also have made a very good policy, and they definitely encourage the all project developers. And in Karnataka also, the at presently, so the capacity addition is, the chances of capacity addition is very less, because in the Talaka wise, our Pavagada solar park and Seki schemes all have come in Karnataka, and they have reached almost its target. So for the new developers, the power demand, it has to be increased, then only the chances are very bright in Karnataka. We are also, as a KPCL, struggling to put up some more projects of solar. But for that, we need to wait for another 2 to 3 years, because the load, the demand has to be increased. And for, as I seen while developing our projects, the challenges are like getting the land is in South Karnataka is very miserable, and in North Karnataka it's okay, we will get, and the farmers also will come forward to give their land on lease basis also. So the getting the land and establishing the plants in Northern Karnataka is very much favorable for everybody, and in South Karnataka it is little difficult, because the most of the lands are very much fertile, and the farmers also don't want to give up their land. So like Pavagada, that terrain is very better also. In such area only you can try for your new projects. And government has already invited tender notification. Hello. To develop some 2 to 3 mega solar projects in 3 districts. So the land acquiring or land taking of land is under process, and in future definitely 3 more parks like Pavagada definitely will come up in Karnataka. In that case, everybody will get good opportunity. And we will also call tender or something else. You people can participate. And definitely in Karnataka's solar radiation is very good. And all the environmental conditions and the support from the government is also favorable to everybody, for the developers. So if any challenges if you are facing in this bringing the new projects, so definitely, to some extent, I can help you. Thank you very much, sir.
That's a very positive outlook that you have given. Definitely the land, yes, as you rightly said, south versus north. But in terms of the overall scenario, I think you're quite positive, yes, in terms of moving forward. That's a great news. Now, I'm going to the top gear now. Now I'm going to request Mr. Pradeep Chauhan, country manager for the solar park COP, to give his kind of, I won't say 30,000, 40,000 feet view, but on the ground realities, hitting the hard in terms of the realities, what is happening on ground, so that we could all relate, but at the same time, moving forward, what could be some solutions which you think could be adopted as well? Thanks.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. I am Pradeep Chauhan. I represent a company based in Spain. We are a fully integrated, diversified solar PV based company. We operate in about 10 countries, and we are having our footprints in India almost like 4 years. Our first investments were in Telangana. We are now operating about 6 projects of 104 megawatts for last 2 years, and now we are blessed to be here in Karnataka. For last 2 years, we have got some projects in Karnataka, cradle scheme, taluka based scheme in 2018, and we have now operational capacity close to 53 megawatt DC, and another 27 megawatt DC must be commissioned this year. So we can say we are a part of Karnataka fraternity for this large renewable energy state. So I would say, what attracts us to Karnataka? So Karnataka is a very rich state in terms of radiations. Then we find that Karnataka transmission system is quite good. I would find it the best of the transmission system in the country in terms of the quality. Yes, they need to expand to absorb more renewable energy capacity, or even any form of the additional of the capacity that has to come. Then Karnataka is a very large state. We may say that yes, land is a challenge. But challenges are, let's say, we can segregate challenges of land into 2-3 different parts. So availability of land is not a challenge in Karnataka. There are a lot many districts, especially in north side of the Karnataka, where either non-fertile land is available in quite big parcels, or there are rain-based farming lands available. And as far as identifying and getting the land in Karnataka is not a very big problem. So people are either willing to sell their land, or also they are willing to give the land on the lease basis for on a long term, 25, 30 years. So that's possible. The challenge in acquiring the land is more related to the process of getting the approvals, clearances done from multiple different offices, and finally getting to the mutations and RTC updated in your project company record, getting it, you know, mortgaged creation. So that is very long process. I think in past government has tried to do certain modifications, certain exemptions, but on ground reality it has not worked. It has not translated to a level when any developer can go and identify a land parcel, and then they can acquire quickly within the timelines which a PPA offers, either 13 months or 18 months. So we have some operational capacities, and the projects are now commissioned of almost like 4 to 6 months now. So we have still not got some of the land related approvals even after the project has been commissioned. So there, I think that will be good if Cradle want to repeat the Pavgada, and they can aggregate large land parcels and take care of the approval clearances process, and then offer to the developers to come in and basically take care of the part of installation, commissioning, and can set up large projects, either in ISTS category or in SECI or state bids. So these are some of the real challenge which we have observed in last 1.5 years. On the side of technology, modules, cost, and how can developers source local manufacture modules? I was in a recent meeting in MNRE wherein every month MNRE secretary invites developers, management people to come and give some of the suggestions that can be included in going forward policy change. So there was suggestions that this safeguard duty implementation, it has created certain disruption in the last 1 year, 1.5 year implementations. And we developers who has commissioned those projects in that duration, we have paid safeguard duty, but we are still facing challenge. How do we get that tariff increase or the, you know, the relief from the regulatory commissions? That's a very, very long process. So so the idea was to open up the tariff ceiling, basically don't have any set tariff ceiling clause in the RFS itself, so that the developer, when they are going for the bid and they want to quote for certain projects, they don't have to just have to look for the cheapest solar module available in the global market to be competitive, and they have room for considering the domestically produced module. So I, being a solar expert and a power sector guy, I am fully aware of who are the manufacturers in this country and how much they can produce or how much they can scale up their manufacturing capacity. It's not a very big challenge to scale up, but it makes a lot of efforts to think whether that additional capacity can be absorbed by the domestic projects. Of course, they are also trying to export from India, but mainly the Indian manufacturers rely on supplying to Indian customers. So that's some suggestions we developer has given to the MNRE in the last month meeting. This month meeting, the 1st of February. And let's see if that works out. I think that if the tariff pressures are not that high from either the bidding agency or the developer in themselves, going to the lowest tariff, 2.4, 2 point something like that, should not be the case. And then projects would be much better in terms of bankability. We would not have any such of pressure of importing modules from XYZ reasons. There will be no safeguard duties, and both the sides of manufacturing and the development sites will be profitable. I think that should be the healthy sign, healthy way of developing any industry in any form. That's one side of it. And there are a couple of suggestions that I would like to make, which basically affects any of the developer on the ground level, that there are certain aspect specifically in Karnataka wherein we have very good policy level at the government. From the government side, we have CRADL, which is one of the best professional nodal agency I have ever interacted in India. I'm blessed with developing projects in most of the renewable energy states for last 10 years. However, when it translates to going to the DISCOMs and going to the district commissioner office for various approvals, the communication gap is something which needs to be covered up. It doesn't travel so fast and it takes a whole lot of time. And developer has to run behind each and every door, even though we consider there has to be a single window for such kind of projects, but it didn't happen actually. Then there are a couple of other issues which are linked to payments and all receivables. So one is that every PPA in this country I have seen or I have ever signed up or I have developed a project has always a provision for opening of the LC 1 month before commissioning of the project. I have rarely seen any of the DISCOM has opened LC before the commissioning of the project or even after commissioning, immediately after commissioning the project. A lot of follow-up is gone. We have not seen LCs. And I must say that one of the DISCOM in Karnataka have recently opened one of the projects LC in last month. That's one exceptional case, which I would say yes. But without LC, we are like at the receiving end. And if payment doesn't come for 5 months, 6 months, the project, whatever assumption we must have taken, it goes for a toss. And we start becoming, exposed to the lenders, because the lenders will start, after 6 months' time, they'll start putting up their install limits to be charged. So it's just a 6 month period of moratorium, which any lender would provide. So there are a couple of things which I think if government of Karnataka can look into, energy department can look into removing those hurdles which are interdepartmental basically. Karnataka would be a fantastic state to work, and this is what my personal experience is working in Karnataka. I have experience of developing a 100 megawatt project in a third party market in 2016-17. And now we have recently commissioned a couple of projects, and going forward we will be looking for developing more projects in CIL market on the ground mounted segment, provided that their policies are quite smooth. Thank you very much.
Wonderful, Pradeep. Really, you hit the ground. Reality is quite direct, and that's the beauty, right? In terms of the players who are involved here in this room and outside. We see this on a day-to-day basis, but how to overcome this is a major issue, and how to come together is also another challenge. So that's a very valid point that you said, that any developer would face. But I like the comment on the LC part. Madhya Pradesh had tried that quite successfully. Even for rooftop, they had tried to open up the LC for the RESCO project. So that's quite interesting, kind of a deviation from what has been promised before and what is not happening on ground. So
Dinesh, I was just amused by one of the DISCOM. They opened LC just 1 month after the commissioning of the project in Karnataka, one of the project. I was so amused, and that's what I'm saying, but that's an exceptional case.
Yeah, but that's the way forward, right? We have to really have such safeguards for the securing the revenues. So now moving from ground to the roof, I'm going to invite Mr. Subramaniam from Enerpark Energy to give his experience again, not on ground, but on roof actually.
Yep, sir. Thanks, Dinesh. Enerpark Energy Private Limited in India is held by Enerpark Hamburg. We are a completely privately held company. In India, we started operations in 2012. In fact, our first order was a commercial and industrial order, so to say. So in a sense, we are perhaps one of the first guys who started in the C&I space, ground-bound that too, next to a active runway. So the Delhi International Airport, the 2 megawatts was installed by Enerpark Energy way back in 2013. Now, globally, Enerpark has a portfolio of about 1.6 gigawatts of assets. We are the top developer in Europe, and we have done about 2 gigawatts of projects as a general contractor, out of which 1.6 gigawatts are our own projects. Now, coming to the remaining 600 odd megawatts of projects that we have executed. We have done them in various locations, some of them in India as well. So all the way from Chernobyl to Ukraine, and some projects in US. Recently we divested our US arm. We sold it to Lego, the toy manufacturing company, because they were interested in a sustainability investment due to large plastic consumption for their toys. Now, coming to the India story for us, as I said, we started with installing a 2 megawatt solar power plant right next to the Delhi International Airport runway, and expanded that to 7 megawatts, and then again relocated that because the runway was going through the actually plant later. So we had quite some lessons learned. We in India, not just CNI, we have helped a lot of developers build solar power plants as a BOS contractor. And in the last 2.5-3 years, we have been predominantly focusing on providing solutions for the rooftop. And that too in the CNI, if I may just dissect it off, and I'd say it's largely to industries, not even to commercials, because commercial roofs to a large extent are small. And if we are to give it to commercial establishments, it would be like for airports or ports or facilities where, you know, you have the availability of land to put up a solar power plant. So challenges, yeah, so like Damien pointed out in his session, in his talk, the OPEX market, we have a 10 megawatt OPEX portfolio that we built in the last 2 years, largely to companies which have a BBB plus or above rating. But now, you know, some of the regulations that have recently been propped up by the Karnataka state in particular completely eliminate the possibility of doing an OPEX project for us. I mean, we are still confused whether it is entirely gross metering or gross metering plus a PPA that we can sign with the owner of the facility, or it is just that, you know, we sign up a PPA with the state. And quite recently, we have come across one more notification that talks about no banking, but only wheeling. But anybody who takes a reference to the grid for setting up a rooftop power plant should also sign a wheeling agreement with the, you know, with the DISCOM. And again, the recent regulation that has been released, I think, towards the end of last year by KERC also talks about ESCOMs being a part of the selection for the EPC vendors also. It's not just the OPEX that they want to sort of get into, but in the CAPEX also, they are saying that anybody who wants to set up a CAPEX system should necessarily involve the ESCOM as an integrator or an aggregator, sorry, and then they would do a reverse auction amongst the possible EPC players. So, I mean, there's quite some confusion that has been created. So anytime we go to a client and talk about solar power and how easy it will break even in about 3 years, like what Damien pointed out, it's we are also not quite convinced as to what to talk to them about the policy and where it stands, right? So, I mean, just in the union budget, we heard the, finance minister, ma'am, saying that, you know, she urges all the states to replace the conventional energy meters with smart meters in the next 3 years. And that would give the consumers freedom to choose the supplier and the rate as per their requirement. Now, we are seeing a diametrically opposite stance being taken by the state government here, right? I mean, there is, I would dare say, there is an absolute lack of alignment. And as if the state and center are not talking to one another. Mr. Mahendra Jain, I wish he was here. When he was talking about, he vaguely mentioned, and this was his verbatim, the consumer model hasn't taken off for rooftops. So we're talking about 200% CAGR in rooftops. That hasn't even happened in the case of ground mount with the government pushing in whatever manner it wanted to push. See, it's simple. I think the gentleman here from the State Electricity Board said that, you know, there is a competition that solar is creating. That is clear and everybody acknowledges it. And it is where the future is going to be. So it's good to embrace the change rather than try to resist it and cull any possible, you know, innovation. You know, he mentioned quite, generously about storage. And if you would really want that to take off, having a policy change like what they did in the last year, in December, I don't think in any way that helps or facilitates that. See, you know, honestly, the whole Indian solar sector has seen a consolidation once. A lot of players dropped out, a lot of developers dropped out. I think Mr. Narasimhan was talking about aggressive bidding. People who bid for accelerated depreciation, people who bid for stuff that they are otherwise not critical to the solar model, had they are run, and then some of them still survive, some of them are dropped out. But what is happening in the CNI segment, either it is ground mount or rooftop, is beautiful because it is by itself sustaining, surviving and growing. And any facilitation that the state is giving should not be taken away, in a sense, you know, and state getting into aggregating or, you know, developers or aggregating EPCs is perhaps going back to license Raj, if I may dare say. I don't think that's, I mean, sorry for being so acidic in the remark, but that shouldn't be the case, right? These are a few things, and I think also somebody was pointing about hydropower and hydropower being a significant component. Sir, I think you are only talking about the operation costs of generating a kilowatt hour from hydropower. No bank today lends for hydropower. They run away when you talk about hydropower. It's about 9 to 10 crores per megawatt, and the issues with respect to land and issues with respect to aggregation, I mean, are enormous, you know. Solar power, actually, you know, land, today many developers feel land is not a constraint because unfortunately much of the barren land is available due to lack of irrigation facilities, and farmers in whatever straits they are, they feel benefited actually leasing off land or selling off land rather than actually, you know, not resisting that. I mean, Pradeep was just saying it's easy to acquire land in Karnataka. So these are a few things, and as Enapark, yes, the recent Karnataka regulation doesn't help us grow the way we were growing. We have three facilities, two in Mysore, one we are about to build, but you know, we really don't know whether to do that or not. We have a PPA that is signed, and we just are not building the asset. Because when we tell the client also that this is the ruling, they say, okay, what do we do now? No. There's no clarity, right? So lack of clarity on behalf of the state policy bodies is very evident, yeah. So I'd perhaps leave it there and let it stay, and everybody understand and reflect on it, yeah? Thanks.